welcome to our show, Festival Brighton 2019. And we're going to start it with my guest, Mark Allen, who is a comedian, and he's going to talk to us about an unusual show, I think. Is that right?
That is. Well, I mean, it's slightly unusual for me. It's a storytelling show, which I'm normally stand-up. And I've had a bit of a departure this year because I've got three under six children, and so my days of going out at night and doing late night stand-up gigs is sort of overtaken by my desire for a good night's sleep.
Fair enough.
So I've written a storytelling show. It's a comedy storytelling show about a man called Leonard who has retired and he's a little bit bored in his retirement, so decides that he's going to enter a chili eating competition.
Right, just like the chili eating competitions we have in Brighton sometimes.
Very much actually inspired by it. And okay. The weird thing is, the chili eating competitions that I've seen in Brighton, I don't know, have you seen any?
No.
The ones I've seen in Brighton are in Victoria Gardens.
Yes, I know that.
So it's weird because there's shows at the Warren, so it's the same site as Victoria Gardens.
And I do often wonder why people, A, do it, and why people go and watch it.
Well, I know why people go and watch it, because it's fascinating. It's intriguing to watch. And so a lot of that informs the show, and the big part of the show is the actual competition itself. There's the background of how Leonard gets into it and why he gets into it, and then the show itself and the different chilies that you eat and the sort of the experiences of going through the pain threshold many times over.
And I know that it's a funny show, A, because you're a comedian, but also B, because of the ridiculous element, I guess. But it's quite a poignant story as well, is that right?
Yeah, it's got a bit of heart to it. It's about, it's set in a village called Frackleton, which is a fictional village, a kind of a small town sort of mentality where everyone knows everyone's business. So a lot of it is about redemption, about Leonard's desire to redeem himself after an earlier incident with chili back in the 1970s, where he humiliated himself in front of the whole village and is still ridiculed for it. So this is about him sort of getting his redemption.
And he's doing it without his wife's knowledge, is
that
right?
Well, yeah, because she'll try and stop him from doing it because she knows that he's not very good with spice. So he decides to go undercover, which is what they put on the flyers you'll see here. This is the flyer. I've always got one available. So that's him there undercover. That's not actually him. That is my dad. Yeah, who agreed to have his photo taken. I don't think he agreed to have it blown up and put all around the Warren. so he'll enjoy that when he comes to see the show.
I'm sure.
But yeah, he's... I think part of it is probably inspired by my dad.
Okay, so it's happening here at the Warren?
Happening here at the Warren. We've got lots of different dates throughout May. 12th of May is the first show, which is a Sunday, and that one is during, I'm going to read because it's at different times, at 3:15. And then the 20th of May at 9:15. 15th of May at 9:15, 20th of May at 7:45, and then 25th, 26th and 27th, that whole bank holiday weekend. 25th is 1:45 and 26th and 27th is 7:45.
Okay, but people can look it up as well.
There's no excuse not to come because it's every time most days.
And so just the name of the show again?
Is Leonard Feels The Heat.
Leonard Feels The Heat. Thank you so much, Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. That's bound to be a hot show, and another hot show, or two, in fact, we're going to discuss right now with Brian Mitchell. Hello, Brian. You're
Hello.
A writer and a performer.
That's right.
And you've got two shows this festival.
That's great.
Let's start with the first one.
Well, we're doing What Do You Know We're In Love at a Boat, at an open-air theatre on this Saturday. That's a very, very silly musical comedy, kind of very kind of Hope and Crosby, Marx Brothers. It's set on an ocean liner, very swing era song, set in a kind of mythical post-war, late 40s, early 50s. There's four performers, Amy Sutton, Joshua Crisp, myself and David Mouthfield, and we actually play the band on the cruise ship, so we play all the songs ourselves. And the songs are written by Jerry Rolfe, who's a magnificent songwriter, musician, bass player, known of old in this parish.
So it's a musical comedy.
Yes, it is. Yes, lots of songs, but it's a short and sweet. It's about an hour long because it's so much silliness. How much souffle can you have? And then after the interval, there's a set from the Spud Guns, which is Andy Roberts and Jerry Rolfe's magnificent rockabilly.
So
outfit.
People will be able to.
Yeah, yeah, they'll
oh,
be able
fantastic.
To dance afterwards. So it's a song and a dance basically, and that's at Boat. And if the weather holds out, it's lovely. It'll be a lovely evening. There's going to be a lot of rockabillies there, so there'll be quite a lot of vintage cars, no doubt, sort of lining up
along
the Boat, so out a long dark road. And on Sunday, the 12th, 13th, 19th, 20th and 26th at Rialto Theatre, we're doing Those Magnificent Men, which is Minor Joseph Nixon's play about Alcock and Brown. Many people don't know this story, bizarrely, but actually 100 years ago, in 1919...
Exactly 100 years ago.
Yes, the June 1919, the first ever non-stop transatlantic flight was done by Alcock and Brown, who were British aviators, and they did it in the converted Vickers Vimy. They did an open cockpit. They flew from Newfoundland to Clifton off the coast of Ireland.
And then crashed a bit, did they?
Oh, yeah, they crashed. It's an amazing story. It's a fabulous, thrilling, but very funny as well. I mean, it's full of thrills and spills, and it's a great story of British understatement and daring do and make do and mend as well, you know, because they didn't have that much money to do this. We wrote the play, Joseph and I, years ago for New Perspectives. It did very, very well. It did very well in Edinburgh and it toured. And we've been, Farage Group have been performing it now on and off since 2015. So it's notched up a lot of performances. But this year, we're doing lots of airfields and air museums. We're doing the Fisher celebrations at Bexley and at Brooklands. And at we're doing like 6 performances at Clifton for the big celebrations, all cooked around 100. And we are performing it 5 times at the Rialto.
Very lucky to have you here.
People who don't know this story, too few people know this story. They did it 8 years before Lindbergh. It's an astonishing feat.
So it's a bit of a history lesson as well.
Yeah, it is. But it's about two actors who are arguing about how it's best to tell this story. One of them wants to over-dramatise it, and the other one wants to just stick to the facts. But say.
And you're one of the two.
I mostly play John Alcock. I mean, they're all much younger than us, but that's another joke in the play. They were so bizarre, you know, in their early 20s, really. So it's come straight out of the First World War.
Can pass for early 20s.
I don't think even my early 20s I could pass for my early 20s. But we have a few jokes about that. But it's always gone very well, and it's only been seen once before, one occasion before in Brighton. So it's strangely mine and Joseph's probably our most successful show, but it's been very, very little seen.
Okay,
here.
So go and watch. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Timpson the musical is, I'm told, a mixture of sort of Shakespeare, sort of the film Airplane, which is an odd combination.
Yeah.
And I've got Sabrina and James to talk about it. Let's start with you, Sabrina.
Yes, so Timpson the musical, it's based on Romeo and Juliet, loosely based on the star-crossed lovers and two warring houses. You've got the Montagues and the Capulets. I know what you're thinking, it writes itself, those puns alone. It's a lot of fun, it's for all the family. We've had a great time doing it, haven't
we? Yeah, absolutely. It's been a lot of fun.
It's a lot of fun to do.
It's fun to see, and it's just a laugh for everybody, really.
Right, yeah. Are you the two main actors? Do you fall in love?
I'm her father.
Yeah. You're her father. Of course you are, I can see
The resemblance is uncanny,
the
isn't
beard.
It? Yeah.
Right, so where did the idea come from? Is it from Shakespeare originally, or?
Yeah, so we have a friend, Sam, who's in the show. He wrote it and he wanted a wacky idea for a new musical and came up with Timpson.
Yeah.
Him and his friend Chris Baker, and they came up with this. I think Romeo and Juliet sort of came as a sort of later thought, but it always had to be wacky.
More of a framing device.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, but it always had to be wacky and always had to be fun, which is sort of Giggle Mug, really.
Yeah.
It's a theatre company.
In a nutshell.
Yeah.
Okay. So a lot of singing, a lot of dancing. As well.
Yeah, it's got it all actually.
Yeah, it does.
I'd say surprisingly, but like it does. It really, really does, and it's sort of it's not your traditional musical, but it has all the traditional elements, I think, as well as.
Okay, sounds good. And after Brighton, where are you going with it?
So we've got a run in London at the end of August. For details on times, location, dates, all that sort of stuff, follow us on social media. So that's Twitter and Facebook, Giggle Mug Theatre. And then you can find out when it all sort of drops.
Great.
Well, all the info, when it
sounds very exciting. Timpson the musical. Thank you so
much.
Thank
you.
Cheers.
Hi, we're at the Warren at Brighton Fringe. Brighton, 250,000 people, but a million dreams. And they're all on the fringe. And Jade Dragon, she sounds like a pop star. She's going to see them all. How are you going to do it, Jade?
It's going to be a marathon over the next couple of weeks. Art and culture, theater, dance, film. I'm taking it all in, and I'm very happy to come back to you and tell you all about it.
When?
When's
the show on?
Every day. Every day. At our show,
yeah.
Our show,
yeah.
8:30, every day, latest TV.
That's it, Channel 7. Watch.
Welcome back. With me is Guy Lloyd and Kev Heritage. We're going to start with speaking to Guy about the show that he's performing, and Kev, the director, will talk to us about the show in a minute. Guy, tell me about the show. What is it?
It's called Radio Blah Blah. We've done a show earlier this week already. Sold out crowd, went really well, surprisingly. And we have the same show again at the end of the month on June the 2nd. It's all about my life before I got into radio. So as I said, I was in social care, made the decision at 30 to change my career into radio, and it's about the whole journey of getting it into Juice Radio, being there for 13 years, all the showbiz stories, and also the less sort of showbiz stories, the less glamorous stuff around that 13-year period, and then Juice being bought last year, and what happened to me immediately after losing a job that I loved. So it's essentially about love and loss and grief, really, with a sort of very autobiographical story.
Right. I mean, you're looking very well and very happy, so maybe some good things happened as a result of the change?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it takes time, doesn't it? It's a big adjustment. And I always knew it was going to come at some point. I was really surprised to have lasted that long on local radio. 13 years is a good run. But yeah, when it's sort of taken away from you and it's not your decision, it's taken away from you.
It's a shock.
Yeah, there's a bit of a shock, and there's some adjustment to make. Because I love the job, and it wasn't just a job. It's not just a case of like, well, it's just 4 hours a day sitting in a studio talking on the radio. It was everything that came with it. It was the lifestyle. It was all the free tickets to gigs. It was being involved in all the events, you know, the Fringe, the Pride, Glastonbury. All those things came from doing that job. So it was the whole lifestyle. My whole lifestyle changed, really.
Okay. Kev, how was it to direct? Sorry?
I said hi.
Hi. Tell me about directing the show and also directing this guy here.
Well, it's been a sort of very interesting sort of experience, spending most of my days listening to Guy Lloyd show off and talk about himself sort of non-stop. But joking aside, it's been a lot of fun. You know, we've both come together. He's got a lot of material, a lot of things he could talk about for the show. And really, my sort of role was to bring it together from a technical point of view, because I create all the graphics and get all the sound and everything together. And work with him to sort of shape it and to put it, you know, to how it is now, really.
And you're happy with the result?
Well, yes. Last night's show was absolute humdinger. So, yes, very, very happy.
Fantastic. Guy, tell us when the second show is again, so people know.
It's June the 2nd, back here at the Warren, at the Blockhouse, which is a lovely venue. And we get about 115 people in there. I know the first show is sold out, and the second show is half full already. So buy your tickets to the usual places. It's been great fun. We've really enjoyed it. We're looking forward to the second show. It's a show that we hope we can take anywhere. It's got a lot of Brighton references, obviously, but it's a show that we feel that we could do again later in the year, and possibly take to Edinburgh as well next year. So
it's your very first solo show, is that right?
Yeah, it's the first solo show. So Kev's been brilliant at just, like I said, shaping it, because I'd quite happily, as you know, Yale, just stand behind a microphone and talk for hours about myself. But I did need someone to sort of put it all together and tell me what worked and what didn't work. And I'm also very precious about my work, so it's been quite a journey collaborating with someone else. because I'm quite a control freak. So it's been really good to sort of let that go and get Kev's views on what works and what doesn't work. So yeah, I've loved the whole process, and I've kind of got the bug now. I'd like to do more. I've done loads of stuff with other people, but I want to do more of my own thing now on stage. I think and that's what's great about losing the job at Juice. That's what's come out of it. It's finding something new that I really enjoyed and putting my energies into that. You know.
Sounds good. Thank you so much for coming and best of luck.
Thank you, Yael.
Okay, and now we're going to talk about The Great Escape and watch a few films. Have you been to any of The Great Escapes before?
Yes, I've been to it's been going for years, isn't it? Probably the last 10 or something like that. I love The Great Escape. I always look at the list and think, no, haven't heard of them. No, haven't heard of them. Haven't heard of them. But that's the beauty of it. I love the fact that you just go into any of these venues and just randomly see a band, and it's hit and miss. Sometimes it works out and you find a real gem, and sometimes it doesn't. But, you know, some amazing acts have come through The Great Escape, and I'm really looking forward to it again, just sort of romping around Brighton.
Great, let's have a look at some selection of The Great Escape.
Take it over.